Winter, can we please come up here? Please, please, please don't leave me alone, please. Please, Daniel, where are you? Daniel, can we please get up here? We're not done, we're not done. Please be very expectant. I'm trusting God to do awesome works this morning. The Lord wants to heal you. Be expectant at the end of this session. The Lord is going to flood this place with a spirit of joy. Because I've realized that some of you have been crying for too long. And I'm not talking about tears. I'm talking about where the problem just goes over and it just goes over and it's just a cycle. And I don't know about you, but I'm tired of a cycle of pain. I need a cycle of joy. Now clap if you mean it, if you really expect it. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Okay, coming down from this side, there's this pain on your heel. There's just pain in your heel. Every time you walk coming down from this side, the Lord wants to heal you. Come very, very quickly, please. There's heat going through your heel in the name of Jesus. Heat going through your heel in the name of Jesus. Heal that heel in the name of Jesus. Feel that heat that's healing all over you, all over again in the name of Jesus. Just heat, just heat. Jesus, 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 touch. No, it has to end. It has to end. It has to end. It has to end. In the name of Jesus, touch. Touch. In the name of Jesus, this has to end. That cycle that has to end. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. See, it's just heat. Don't be scared. Don't be scared. Don't be scared. You don't have to fall. It's just heat. Right leg, symptoms on the right leg. Just heat. In the name of Jesus. There's somebody coming down from this side. You could not. Okay, right shoulder. You could not raise your hands. You can't even worship God this way. Down here. You're coming down this side. Come very, very quickly. Feel the heat all over your hands. Now throw your hands up and praise God. You couldn't do it before. Throw your hands up. Throw your hands up and give Him worship. Come, come, come. Higher than that. The gospel of faith. Come on. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Now wave your hands. Oh, oh, wave your hands. Pain, go in the name of Jesus. Go, go, go. Get out. Get out of this body in the name of Jesus. 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 You will not stop. Sister from praising God. You will not stop your sister from praising God. You will praise Him forever and ever. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Don't be silent, please. Give God some praise. There's somebody here with laryngitis problem in your throat. You know, about 2 weeks ago, I was praying, and the Lord said, Rowan, I need you to learn medical terminology. And I said, for what reason? I'm 37, man. I can't go into the medical field now. You know, I love what I'm doing. Theology is my thing. I said, why must I learn it? It's because so you know what to call out when you need to call it out to heal.
Amen.
How are you going to know what to call out if you don't know these medical terminologies? So I said, okay, fine, because I want to use you in that field. So how are you going to know what to call out? So excuse me for not saying the right terminologies. I'm still learning it. Is laryngitis something on your throat? You already went for a scope. You're coming down from the middle section. You already went for a scope, and you can't really seem to know what is going on, but it keeps on troubling your throat and inside. laryngitis and it's affecting your voice, please, one person, run out your way very quickly.
Amen.
Don't think about it. Don't waste time about it. Just run out your way quickly, please. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. All what I said, does it make sense to you? All what I just said now, does it make sense to you? Yes. So, in the name of Jesus. What's it say?
From last week, it's 2 weeks back, but I went to the pharmacy, they give me medication, but it's not working.
It's not working. How if you know medication doesn't work, but Jesus works right? Yeah. Lord, heals through. Remove every pain and everything that is not supposed to be here. In the name of Jesus. Jesus, I give you the praise.
Amen.
I give you the glory. Just leave her there because there's some other things that the Lord wants to deal with her as well. She doesn't need to hear this word. She's right now just with Him. And it's Jesus and nothing else. Got nothing to do with us now. It's just Him and her. Just leave her where she is. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Kimmy. Thank you, guys. Hallelujah. Jesus is Lord.
Amen.
I want to talk to you very, very quickly. Then we're going to move on to what the Holy Spirit wants to do. Amen. On a topic called a faith kind of joy. Everybody needs joy. I don't know about you, but everybody needs joy. If there's one thing that the enemy attacks, it's your joy. If there's one thing that the enemy attacks, it's your joy. Everybody, okay, you might say, but why joy? I mean, there's love, there's peace, there's even grace. Why joy? Let's look at love. Everybody has love. Nobody here can say that they do not love somebody else. Right? Amen?
Amen.
And nobody here can say that they do not have somebody else that loves you. Everybody here is full with love. You can smack your kids across the head, but you will never, ever, not once tell them, "You useless, I hate you." Bah! If there's any child here that has experienced that, please come and see us. That is completely wrong. Nobody does it. You will be so mad. And so, oh my God, I have 3 kids. We go through this every day. At different levels. Age 3, age 9, age 14. They're different levels. But at no time do I tell them I hate you. I might be disappointed. I might want to hit them so hard. Jesus help me. But at no time will I tell them I hate you. You can smack your kids and be so angry with them, but you will still love. What is stolen from you when you hit your children? Thanks, thank you guys. Come back. What is stolen when you hit your children? What is stolen when you hit your children? Your joy. Your joy on the inside. There's something about joy, because I've been looking at this and you know, just like the topic on faith, I wanted to experience more. And I still believe there's so much more about faith that I need to know, that we need to know. So there's something about joy that I wasn't just so content with it. And I was puzzling with this. I said, "Lord, give me a new revelation about what is joy." And He gave me this topic, a faith kind of joy. You can't just experience joy. You've got to have a faith kind of joy. So I'm going to give you a revelation of Scripture, and hopefully you will catch it by the end of today. Love bounces back. Love always abounds. Love comes naturally from you because you were made from love. God is love, and everything around him is all about love. So we were made out of his bosom. So we were made from love. So love automatically calls out to love. We automatically are lovable people. I'm sorry, I had to say that a little bit. Let's talk about grace. Grace is unmerited favor. Grace abounds even stronger. Grace is there whether you like it or not. Grace always abounds. It's just grace and grace and grace. Grace for every race. Grace is always there. The peace of God. Peace of God that covers all humans, that passes all humans' understanding. It's always with you. You remember that one time when you just wanted to beat that person up? You all remember that time, right? Yeah. You know what I'm talking about, right? You remember that time when you just wanted to hit this person so hard and you were so mad and you just found peace to just step back and just let it go? Someone tell your neighbor, please. Tell your neighbor, say, let it go. There's avenues in our lives and virtues in our lives where we come to a place where we just have to let it go. And we don't understand how, we cannot fathom how, but we just find that peace within ourselves to let it go. So peace is there, but there's something about joy. Because it doesn't say peace come in the morning. It doesn't say grace comes in the morning. It says joy comes in the morning. Why would David say joy comes in the morning? Out of everything he could have chosen. He could have chosen anything in this world, because David is a man that was went through so many different avenues in life. We know this. He could have chosen anything, but yet he chose joy. So there must be some revelation of joy that he experienced that we need to know. For him to say, out of everything, joy comes in the morning. You see, the enemy's got your joy, he's got your faith. It's not your joy that he's after, it's your faith that he's after. Because at the end of the day, it is faith that moves the hand of God. It is faith that God answers. It is faith that God hears. It is only your faith that God listens to. It is only faith that God realizes. The Bible says four times that the just shall live by faith. It doesn't say anything else. The just shall live by faith. The only way to get to your faith, the easiest way for the enemy, is through your joy. He can steal anything else. It just doesn't move you that much. But take away your joy. You still have love. You still have peace. Grace is always there. But when your joy is stolen, everything around you just collapses, man. Come on, you know this. When your joy is taken away from you, everything around you just ceases. Everything comes to a halt. It's as if you just want to give up. The best way to get to your faith is through your joy. You can be angry, but you will still love. You can be down, but you will still find peace. You can be sinning, but you will still have his grace. But the only thing that is so easily stolen from you is your joy. You got to have joy down deep. I got to have joy down deep in my soul. Joy is the only thing, if you're taking down notes, joy is the only thing that has got nothing to do with anybody else. You need somebody else to love on. And you need somebody else to love back at you. Peace of God, grace of God. You need somebody else to make you happy. You might need somebody else to make you laugh. But joy, it is something that you experience on your own. It's got to do with you and nobody else. He fills you up with His joy. I'll show it to you just now in the scripture. He will fill you up with His joy, and it is completely on your own. It's got nothing to do with anybody else. Okay, let's go through some scriptures, and then we are done. James chapter 1, please. James chapter 1. James chapter 1, reading from verse 2 down to 6. James chapter 1. Thank you. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials. Wow. Okay. Fine. A little bit. Knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to him. But let him ask in faith, with no doubting. For he who doubts is like a wave of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. Let's break the scripture down. Let's get some revelation from the scripture. Firstly, verse 2. Count it all joy when you fall into various trials. How on earth do you equate a problem with joy? How can you equate a trial with joy? Does it make any human sense for me to put my problem and my joy in the same place? Doesn't make sense. I can put my problem and my tears in the same place. I don't know about you, but I can put my problems and my weeping in the same place. But I cannot put my trials and my joy in the same place. It doesn't make sense. But yet it says, count it all joy when you fall into various trials. Be content, if you take no notes, be content when you go through different trials. Be content when you're going through different trials. Because faith is never faith unless it's tested, right? We know this. Faith is never faith unless it's tested. Let me tell you this way. Faith is not an experience. Faith is a journey. Faith is not just an experience that happens now. Faith is an onward journey. Let me paraphrase this for you. At the end of today's service, you feel this Holy Ghost moment. Say, yo, Pastor, I feel it now. I feel this faith. It's moving inside of me. I'm so excited. I want to do extreme works for God. Oh, praise the Lord, my brother. I'm so excited. I have faith stirred up inside of me. I want to do something for God. I really want to do something. At the end of the service, you're going out, you're speaking to the pastors, you're speaking to the leaders. I'm so excited about what I want to do. I'm so, I can't be stopped. My faith is stirred up, Pastor, by your word. Go back to the car. That was experience. That was an experience. Go back to the car. Where were you? Why are you taking so long? Why you must sit there and talk to the pastor? The children are hungry. Why can't you make fast? Please, just come, let's just go home, please. That experience, gone. Your faith is gone. The last thing you ever want to talk about thereafter is that service. Because you will forever know that that was a service that your wife was upset. No, that's not a true story. I know you're all waiting for that line. That's not a true story, I promise you. But faith is not just an experience, it's an onward journey. It has to be a journey of trials that you have to overcome to have faith to overcome those trials for you to experience at the end a faith kind of joy. There's a season, there's a process, there's a journey of faith. There's a journey of faith. Let's move on. You'll see why there is a journey. Otherwise, you're never going to really get it. Verse 3. Knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. Wow. Okay, wait. Hold up. This now it's who wrote this book? James. Oh, Jesus Christ. He probably was under weed at the time when he wrote this book, because so far it does not make any sense to me what he is saying. Firstly, count it all joy when you fall into various trials. And then he's saying, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. This test of your faith produces patience. Wait a minute. We understand that, yes, sometimes, faith is now, right now, healing takes place right now, faith acts right now, faith works right now. There is a time for that, where faith is now. But that scripture, now faith is the substance. Hebrews 11:1. That scripture also means that now is a time for you to have faith. It doesn't only mean that faith has to act only now. Faith is also a journey. It is not just a one-time experience. And it says faith produces patience. Now, if faith is only answered right now, then why will it produce patience? Because there will be no need for patience if faith produced right now. Because you only need patience for something that is still to come. You only need patience for something that is still to come. If faith works only now, how can faith produce patience? Because patience means that I'm enduring. It means that I'm persevering. It means that I'm going through something. The meaning of this word patience in this context means endurance. It means perseverance. I am going through something. I am waiting on God patiently for something to happen. Patience. My faith is producing patience. My faith is producing patience. Oh, I have patience. I have faith right now. I know faith will work right now for me. I have faith for this miracle. I have faith for that miracle. But there's something else. I know I have to go through a season in order for me to see the end of that faith. Because if I get that answer right now, I will not be able to contain it, because I do not know how to appreciate that blessing right now. So I have to go through a season of patience, faith, so I can appreciate the blessing later. Are you following what I'm saying?
Amen.
So faith produces patience. There will be no need for patience, for patience is for something that is still to come. Verse 4. Let's move on. Verse 4. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. Why? James? Why? I like that name, James. You should have another son and name him James. Yeah. Rewind. Let's start over. Delete. Enough of that topic. Just for the record, no matter how much y'all pray this time, but then we get together all the time, so okay, let's just put a good, you understand what I'm saying. Okay, that's inside joke, that's an adult joke. All children, please, I'm sorry. Okay, let's get back, please. This I get from my dad, I'm sorry. Let's get back. Okay. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. And patience is what makes you mature. It what makes you grow. It what completes you. In other words, if faith answered everything right now, you will never mature. You will never grow up. It says your patience have its perfect work, and you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. What he is saying is, you have to experience faith and patience through your faith, otherwise you will not mature. You will not grow up. So tell your neighbor, have patience. So you can grow up. Patience is what makes you mature. Because if we receive everything that we ever wanted right now, we will still be babies. Look at a child. All of us, we know what it is to have. We have seen a small child. Look at a small child, you give all the gifts to that child. When the child wants something, she or he will just cry. Just cry for what they want. They do not know the value of it. They do not know I have to wait for mommy and daddy to have money to buy it. They do not know we have to wait. Let's get into the car. Let's go to the mall. Hopefully the shop is open. And hopefully they want exactly what you do, what you're desiring. And then we will buy it depending on how much it is. And then only you will get. They don't care about all that. They want it right now. So imagine if we had to get everything right now. What kind of patience will we have? What endurance will we have? So when we go through a test and through a trial, we want to give up because we don't know how to wait in patience and in faith unto God for the breakthrough. So God keeps silent because he gives us his word. He keeps silent. He said, but look at my word. I'm telling you how to keep patient. Look at my word. You don't need to hear from me. I don't need to speak to you. Look at my word. I'm speaking through my word. Have patience. Shh. Wait. There is a time for every breakthrough. And that time is not your time. It's his time.
Amen.
Okay, let's move on. Hebrews chapter 12, just flip. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2 says, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, for who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. I don't know about you, but if you actually read the scripture properly, which we have read the scripture many, many times, but if you read the scripture carefully, slowly, this scripture is literally telling you in one scripture the entire lifespan of Jesus here on this earth, the cross, the crucifixion, the burial, the resurrection, and now seated on the right hand side of the Father. That one scripture is telling you the entire cycle of Jesus Christ. But wait a minute. Looking at Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. How can you call the cross joy? Who wrote this book? Mom, who wrote this book? Author unknown. Yeah, that's what my course is. Whoever it was also under weed. Because here it doesn't make sense as well, because this author is saying that what Jesus went through, the task ahead, endure the cross, the pain of the cross, the suffering, the piercing on the side, all of that pain and agony, the torment, the stripping of his clothes, being naked before the people, stripped him of all righteousness, all glory, made him weak in the sight of man, and he calls it joy? The task ahead that Jesus had to endure was called joy. Go to Psalms 126. Psalms 126. Psalms 126, verse 5. Those who sow in tears shall reap in what?
Joy.
It doesn't say anything else, but those who sow in tears shall reap in joy. I don't know about you, but so far, all the scriptures I've been through, the Bible always equates joy and associates joy with pain, with sorrow, and weeping.
Yes.
We have equated joy with laughter and happiness. Because yeah, I know that song is being joined, but but throughout the Bible we see that joy is equated and associated with pain, with sorrow and weeping. Okay, fine. Go to Colossians chapter 1. That's right up in the New Testament. Colossians, that's I think after Philippians. Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. Chapter 1 from verse 9 down to 11. Listen to this story very carefully. Colossians chapter 1 verse 9 down to 11. For this reason, we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of His will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that you may walk worthy of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Fully pleasing Him.
Thank you, Jesus.
Being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God.
Wow, this is amazing. I don't know about you, but I want to be this guy. Right? I want to be this guy.
Strengthened with all might, according to His glorious power.
And then He drops the ball.
For all patience and long-suffering with joy. Again, it doesn't make sense. You are equating joy with patience. You are equating joy with long-suffering. First He talks about being worthy of God. Then He talks about pleasing Him. Then He talks about being fruitful and multiplying for in every good work. Then He talks about increasing in the knowledge of God. Then He says being strengthened with all might. And then when it comes to joy, it talks about patience and long suffering. How many of you have patience? Honestly, sincerely, you have patience. You can stand in a queue for hours, right? You can stand in a queue for hours. You know, when you go to the bank on the 31st of the month, around 12 o'clock, you go to the bank, you just walk in, you see that queue, and immediately you're behind. I mean, you just got there. You're not even waiting 30 seconds. You just got there, and already you're fuming and you're looking at the time. You just got there, but you're already looking at the time. You know when you're standing at Pick and Pay and there's a long line and you're right in the back with your trolley full. You're standing there and and then while you're trolley, you quickly want to go and get something you just forgot. You come back and then the person right there by the cashier is busy with the cashier, and then the cashier something. What's wrong? This is the other person, right, with the cashier. What's wrong? There's no barcode. What the S? What's wrong? There's no barcode. Please come get the barcode. What the S, please, get the barcode. And that person is fuming. You on this end looks.
Oh.
I told you we should have went to Woolworths. You always want to come to Pick and Pay.
Just by the way, that's not a true story. You can stand in the queue for hours, right? You have patience for hours, right? I mean, you're also perfect Christians. You have patience for hours, right? Lying! We don't have patience. But here the Bible says it equates patience and long-suffering with joy. See, joy doesn't come like peace. It doesn't come like love. It doesn't come like grace. You have to deserve it. You have to have faith for it. It has to be a faith kind of joy. Isaiah 58 verse 8 says, "Then your light shall break forth like the morning." When does joy come? In the morning. The Bible says, it makes very clear reference to this, that Jesus is the bright and morning star. Wait, before you argue with me. Yes, Isaiah just does make reference to Lucifer being the morning star. But Jesus makes a clear reference in the book of Revelation that he is the bright and morning star. Now trust us, please. We are in theology. We know what we're talking about. Please just trust us. This topic can go on for hours to really get. It's another topic altogether. Just trust us. Please. There is no similarity when it comes to Lucifer and when it comes to Jesus. Jesus is the bright and morning star. Amen. And nothing compares to that. Okay. The bright and morning star, meaning the sun that shines through, you know, in the morning, the clouds, and all of a sudden the clouds just disappear, and the sun shines right through, and it hits you full in your eyes. It burns. You know that morning sun? Isaiah 58 says, "Then your light shall break forth like the morning." Joy comes in the morning. Your joy needs to break forth like the morning sun. Just like the morning sun, the bright and morning star shines through on your life in the morning, in the same way, joy breaks through you in the morning. Joy comes in the morning. Last two scriptures and we're done. Psalms chapter 30, verse 5. Psalms chapter 30, verse 5. From the last time, I'm going to repeat a few things just for reference sake. Verse 5 says, "For his anger is but for a moment, his favor is for life. Weeping may enjoy for a night, but joy comes in the morning." Weeping is not only pain, it's also a season of trials. It's also a season of pain that you have to go through. Weeping, it's a course. It's every hour. There is a season. We've been through this last time. There's a season that you have to go through in order for you to experience joy that comes in the morning. So we understand that. There's a season of pain, season of trials, season of sorrow that you have to go through the night, to last through the night. It endures through the night so that joy comes in the morning. When does morning happen? Tell your neighbor, morning happens. Oh, now you're thinking about food. Okay, forget about food. Say it out loud, please. Say, morning happens.
Morning happens.
When you wake up.
When you wake up.
So wake up.
Wake up.
You see, we are going through a season of sleeping, a season of pain and trials and sorrow. And when it comes to the morning, we still want to sleep. And God is saying, wake up. We still want to sleep. And it goes through a season of pain, of sorrow and trials. And it comes to the morning, we still don't want to wake up. We still want to go through the season and pain and trials and sorrow. There's a cycle that we go through day and day and week and month and year. And God is saying,
a season of pain. I need my joy to go past the parking lot. I need my joy. I know you're loving preaching in this place, but I don't know about you. I'm sorry, with all due respect. I need my joy to go past the preaching, Pastor. I need my joy. I love the way you sing, guys. And I love praise and worship. You know that it's all about me and you, fine. But I need my joy to go past your singing. I need my joy to go past all that worship. So when I'm done off the stage and when I'm done in the church praising and worshiping God, when I'm gone home, I need my joy to last forever and ever. I need a season of joy, because I'm tired of a season of pain. I'm tired of a season of sorrow. I need a season of joy to break forth in my life. There has to be a season now of joy. There has to be a faith kind of joy. You see, we are experiencing joy with laughter. We are experiencing joy with fun. We are experiencing joy with smiles. It's good, but for that you need somebody else. But to experience a faith kind of joy, you need this word and nothing else. It's just you and Jesus. It's nothing else. Lord, I thank you for your grace. I thank you for your grace. I thank you for that grace. You've given me so much of grace to go through the situation I'm in. You've given me so much of grace to go through this pain I'm in. Thank you for the grace, Lord, to overwork and less and underpay. Thank you for the grace, Lord, of to going to a home, to an empty apartment. Thank you for the grace for a son that I've raised that doesn't speak to me anymore. Thank you for this grace, Lord. But now I need your joy to remain in me, that my joy may be full.
Amen.
You want the scripture? Go to John chapter 15, verse 11. John chapter 15. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. John chapter 15, verse 11. These things I have spoken to you. This is Jesus speaking. He says, that my joy may remain in you and that your joy may be full. Lord, I need your joy. I don't need somebody else's joy. Keep your joy, because it's not filling.
Amen.
It's not fruitful in my life. I need your joy to remain in me so that my joy may be full. Watch this. This is you. So I'm just doing to this water what life does to you. Turns you upside down, man. Turns you around and around in circles, and you have nowhere to go. Because of all this pain and all the sorrow that I'm feeling, it just makes me feel kind of blue. To everything I'm feeling, it just makes me feel kind of blue. So, you hold this. You give me this. Now this is you. This is you. And this is his joy. This is your joy. This is his joy. Maybe your concentration is not that good. You're concentrating on the wrong kind of joy. It says, his joy may remain in you so that your joy may be full. Maybe your concentration is not that good, so you need to take his joy and you need to fill yourself up with his joy. You need to fill yourself up with his word. And the more you have of his word, the more you have of his joy, the more you have of him in you, your concentration level becomes different.
His joy alone that remains in you. And now you don't feel kind of blue anymore, because it's His joy that fills you up. It's His word that fills you up. It's His word that remains in you, so that your joy can be full. If you need the joy